The Swell Season Podcast is recorded by the NewsStand Studio at Rockefeller Center in the heart of Manhattan and is distributed by the Swell Season Surf Radio Network. Hello, and welcome to the Swell Season Surf Podcast. I'm your host, Tyler Brewer. Our guest for this episode is Emilio Perez. His paintings and works on paper can be described as abstract expressionists with a graphic component. He produces punchy, energetic compositions full of knotted, flowing forms that emerge from loosely painted passages of color. He has been represented by some of the largest galleries in the world and has produced some incredible large-scale pieces in places such as Times Square and the Malecon in Cuba. He came to surfing later in his life, but has been an NYC devoted core surfer for over 20 years, braving many wintry surfs, and holds things down in Bushwick, where his studio has been before it was trendy and hip, before Roberta's, before Momo, and before the graffiti walking tours. Emilio represents that New York success story that we all dream of living. I'm really stoked he's here in the studio with me today. Emilio, welcome to the show.
Thanks for having me, Tyler.
How's that intro? Good?
Excellent. Very well done.
Yeah. You like the whole, like, he was in Bushwick before it was cool.
Well, it's all true. People are like, dude, you're so far out.
Yeah. You're like, really? It's like, not anymore.
Really, it's only five stops. Not anymore.
So let's just like go right into this. You were born in New York City, though, correct?
That's right, yeah.
And then like you mainly grew up in Miami?
Pretty much. We left New York when I was about five. My dad was working for a bank at the time, and we ended up living in Brazil, in Rio, for a couple of years. But you know, by the time I was eight, we were back. We were in Miami. Yeah. And those were sort of like where I had my formative years and then went to college in New York.
But what was it, like Jackson Heights originally?
I was born in Jackson Heights.
Nice. Yeah. Nice. Now, let me ask, like, your parents, they fled the Cuban Revolution in 1961. And like your father is a lawyer. Your mother studied economics. Hardly the types of parents one would imagine for an artist. So I got to ask, like, where did you get your desire to create and paint come from?
Well, it's interesting. So, you know, these are the things that my parents studied in Cuba. But then when they came to this country, in the end, my dad got into banking, so he never practiced law. And my mother was also working at a bank, but she was the one in the family who always had a very sort of artistic side to her. Mm-hmm. And from a very early age, I remember we used to go to Chesapeake Bay, mm-hmm. and she would collect these like big clamshells. Bring them home and she would paint birds in these shells and then like make like a little and then glue together a bunch of other shells to create like a base for these things. So I just remember there always being this box of paints mm-hmm. and like a couple of like how to paint books, you know, when I was a kid. And that was, you know, I think I always had that part of that creative thing in me, mm-hmm. but I had the tools there to do it.
Yeah.
And I was encouraged.
Yeah, I was going to ask, like, were your parents supportive of it? Like, it, from what I've read, like, it sounds like your father was quite stern and domineering. Is that correct?
Like, well, that's probably pretty typical of most, like, you know, Cubans of his generation. And, I mean, certainly supportive of me being creative and making work. And, I mean, I was, like, the, you know, in quotes, the artist of the family. Now, whether we agreed that was going to be, you know, a career choice that would make sense, that's a different story.
Skedaddle. Like, and how did they, like, what was your relationship like then? So, like, the way you describe it, right? Like, your mom being creative and your dad kind of being a bit more of, like, banker, kind of straightforward.
It's, like, practical. And it's very typical, yeah. I think, of the immigrant experience, you know? I mean, you know, so you leave your, you leave this country, and they left as adults.
Yeah.
You know, for a better life for their family, for their kids. And they want to, you know, they want to, they want you to be successful. You know, they don't want you to go through, you know,
hardship. You
know, any hardship or any struggles. So there's something said to be, there's something to be said about, you know, being practical and making those decisions that are going to, you know, create a stable, mm-hmm. sort of, you know, life, career, et cetera.
I can't help but think of, just because I saw it, like The Fablemans. I don't know if you watched that movie.
No, yet. I'm not familiar with it.
It's really good. It's like Steven Spielberg's kind of semi-autobiography
okay.
movie. And it's like you have one parent who's more like numbers and kind of like a certain kind of abilities. And the mm-hmm. mother is like more of the creative. And then the kid who's just kind of trying to be the more creative one and finding that support amongst both the parents, basically. Mm-hmm. And how you navigate that. You know, I was like, do you, with your art then, as you were growing up, like, was it, like, Miami, what was that like? Like, were you, it sounded like from some of the stuff I've read, that you were, like, into this whole kind of little art scene. You had, like, a lot going on. Like, what was, like, Miami like in the 80s, like, kind of growing up in that time and kind of trying to be an artist or trying to express, you know, yourself as a high schooler?
Well, in the 80s, I don't know how much of an art scene. I mean, there's always been some sort of an yeah. art scene anywhere, right?
Yeah.
I think, like, the sort of the contemporary art world really started to sort of evolve in Miami, you know, sometime in the 90s.
Yeah.
But in the 80s, when I was in high school, like I said, I'd always been drawing. I'd always been doing this stuff. I was the yeah. artist of the family. And I think I've thought a lot about this in the context of this recent show that I did. But I've been thinking a lot about the reasons why I got into making art in
yeah.
the first place. And for me, it was part of it was, you know, just an escape, you know, because I was also quite different than everybody else in my family, too.
Yeah.
But in high school, I just happened to have, maybe I just gravitated to, but I happened to have a bunch of friends who were artists. Mm-hmm. We were all in the same AP art class. I think our senior year of high school, we had like 4 or 5 art classes back to back
yeah.
with this awesome teacher who was super supportive. And it really... And it was her, she was the one who, you know, I thought, well, I'll probably, you know, maybe I can study architecture because I was kind of interested in that. And art wasn't really a reality. I never thought it was. And then yeah. this teacher who was very encouraging, she's like, listen, you know, you should, why don't you apply to go to art school? And I was like, oh, wow, is that, you know, can I do that? Does that make sense? And I did. And it was amazing because I got into Pratt and I went to school here. And she quit her job that fall, I think the year that we graduated, and then went to grad school at Pratt. So I was going to school at the same time with my high school art teacher. I mean, she's like, at the time she seemed a lot older, but she wasn't really that much older than us.
So her name was Tatiana, is that it?
Yes. Wow, you did your homework.
I did my homework, and I came prepared. I'm curious, and like, God, like your parents must have been like, who's this teacher influencing my kid, telling yeah. him to go to school for art, you know?
Yeah.
Not architecture, at least.
Well, I think they liked the fact that she was Cuban. And I think that, like, there was some, I don't recall exactly, but yeah. there was some sort of connection with her family. Like, somebody knew somebody. But yeah, I mean, she was really I think that she was the catalyst for sort of setting me in a direction. Mm-hmm. Or at least, like, showing me that there was a possibility to actually turn this into a career. I mean, I didn't know what I was getting into, honestly. But it's what felt natural to me.
Let me ask, like, then, like, how much of the Cuban community in Miami were you seeped in growing up? Was it like all around you as well, or was it something that felt more distant?
No, I mean, it was definitely, you know, omnipresent in yeah. my life. But I've always, when I've talked about this, I've always said that I've sort of, you know, I've always felt like I lived in two worlds because at home, you know, I grew up in a very sort of traditional Cuban house
yeah.
and, you know, with my grandmothers and, you know, speaking Spanish at home. Outside of school, I had friends from all over the place. And where I went to high school, that high school in particular was actually quite diverse. You know, so you had kids from Key Biscayne and Coconut Grove and Coral Gables going there. But then you had a lot of Cuban kids going there. So it was very international.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, for a public school,
yeah.
I guess, in Miami. but So I just had these dual lives. I had a lot of American friends, you know, whose parents were way different than mine. They were way more relaxed and way cooler, and like, you know, it's just a different thing.
It's interesting, like, because when you're a teenager, particularly, I feel like we're always searching to belong.
Yes.
Right. We're all like looking for an identity as well. And I'd read somewhere like you really identified as an artist almost in high school, or use that as a way to kind of create some sort of identity for yourself.
Well, you're absolutely right. And I didn't really recognize this and understand it until pretty recently in my life. You know, maybe, you know, within the last 10 years, I've realized how I was when I was a teenager, that I like this, how I had this need for an identity, because again, I didn't feel 100% Cuban. I didn't feel 100% American. So I was like kind of somewhere in the middle, but I was 100% artist.
Right.
So I think that had a lot to do with the fact that I persisted and managed to have like some level of success as an artist, because that passion of mine was completely linked to my identity. So if I'm not making art, who am I?
Right.
You know? And so that was something, and I never thought about it that way. And once it kind of like, once I had that light bulb moment, I was like, you know, I started looking back and I was like, wow, well, this all starts to make so much more sense. And that artist's identity was able to sort of encapsulate both parts of my life.
Right. It's a way of like blending those two kind of,
sure.
It's almost like Venn diagram, you know, like we have the circle, and here's Emilio in the middle almost, you know,
exactly.
Like it's, you know, it's funny because that's how I viewed myself as, you know, not an artist, but I identified as a surfer. Mm-hmm. It was a real huge part of my personality growing up. I grew up in an area where there were no surfers, no one surfed, no one knew it, and I never felt completely comfortable with a lot of the kids that I grew up with, but it was... The surfing was the identity I could cling to, and it's amazing like how you can avoid a lot of shit too by having that.
Absolutely.
You know, like you can avoid kind of going along with a lot of people doing dumb things, you know, or getting into bad things, because at least like this is where I stand. That doesn't align with like how this type of personality or how I perceive this this person to be almost, right? Like, let me ask you then, like, what do you think, like, do you think, who is Emilio Perez without art then?
That's a good question.
You ever think about that? Like, I sometimes think, like, what if surfing were stripped from me? What if I were injured and could never surf? How would I identify myself then?
Well, I think that, I mean, it's hard to imagine that, that being the case, but I, you know, when I realized how much of my identity was tied to what I decided to do, I did have those thoughts. And I think now I'm just okay with being Emilio, honestly. You know, I've had a lot of amazing experiences. And one of the great things that this kind of career path has offered me is that I've met people from all different walks of life, from all over the world. And it puts me, I'm very comfortable pretty much anywhere I go.
Yeah.
And that, you know, makes me comfortable with myself, I guess.
Totally. Well, you went to Pratt then. What years was this when you went to Pratt?
So like I moved.
Early 90s, would you say?
Yeah, early 90s. I started at Pratt in 1990, and then I dropped out in 92.
What kind of culture shock was it for you coming from Miami to New York? Especially, I think, for a lot of our listeners, a lot of people don't realize what New York City was like around that time.
I've got tons of stories, but
here we go.
I'll tell you the one from my first day at Pratt. And I'd applied to a couple of different art schools. And I think kind of one of the things that turned it for me was that we went to visit a couple of different schools in the Northeast, and Pratt was offering that you could come up and stay in a dorm with some of the students. And I did that, and I had a really good time. And it was a little bit more, I'd gone to see SVA, but SVA didn't really have like a campus, and it was kind of in the city. So it was like a lot more intimidating. That like Pratt seemed like a little bit more sort of self-contained.
It's got a campus. It's got like
dorms. Except the neighborhood was like a total war zone.
Yeah.
And New York was just completely different. You know, yeah. I mean, that was the height of the crack epidemic. I mean, you couldn't walk down the street and you're just like crunching on empty crack bottles everywhere. You know, gunshots every night. You know, you'd hear them, you know, from the dorm. But so that first day that we moved in, my roommate, who was had also been in my high school art class, he was a good buddy of mine, James Murphy. We show up, and I'll never forget, we were like in this lousy dorm that was only, it was supposed to be a temporary building, but they kept it up. And it'd been, you know, we get there and we open the window, and I'm standing there next to my buddy. And I was like, well, James, like, look, you know, we made it, man. We're in New York. We're going to school. And as I'm saying it, on the far corner, a gunfight breaks out. Meanwhile, I can see the police station on the other corner, like a block away. And we're like, what have we done? You know, and people are like, they're like, man, you guys are from Miami. You must be used to this stuff. I was like, I don't know. I was like, you've been watching too much Miami Vice. Like, this is insane. And it was rough. I mean, I think that, you know, when you're a kid and you just like, you know, you kind of get desensitized to things. But it was pretty rough. And I'll be honest with you. I wasn't, you know, New York was a different place. I don't think I was really prepared to get away from Miami and get away from being, you know, with my parents.
Yeah.
But I don't think I was prepared for New York at the time. And I think that contributed to me leaving school and moving back to Miami, not to move in with my parents, but to move into Miami, to move back there. And that was like, I mean, that was kind of a crazy place too back then.
Well, like, how is it with the classes then? Did it stack up to what you thought you should be learning, or what your idea of what you'd be learning at that time? Did they have you drawing circles like 120 something times?
I mean,
or anything
your
like
first
that?
Year you take your core classes. Yeah. So there's like, you know, drawing, sculpture, color theory, that sort of thing. Honestly, I just wasn't that into it. I was more into, you know, just living and partying, really. Like, I just wasn't, I don't think I was mature enough, honestly, to even be able to answer that question, because I don't think I was invested in what I was doing. It was such a wild time for me. But I think important, you know, as far as my development went, I think that there was some aspect of having come here and had that experience that gave me like a certain kind of confidence, maybe.
Did you like study, like in high school, were you studying artists or art history at all, or was it okay? So you had
that
foundation.
I did have a foundation in art history.
Yeah, I didn't know.
Like, it was something that was interesting to me. I'd always gone to museums. You know, I'd always, you know, gotten books from the library. Right. You know, and like there were certain things that
gonna be trouble getting those books from the library these days in Florida.
Yeah. Well, yeah, true. But I think about young artists today. It's like, you know, one of the challenges is finding your voice as an artist. And I think about when I was like sort of my formative years, you know, my access to information was very limited. You had like encyclopedias, you know, like National Geographic. You could go to the library to get stuff. You know, you didn't have a thing in your pocket that has billions of images, you know, and, you know, that you have to kind of sift through to kind of understand, like, what is it that, do I really like this, or am I liking this because somebody else is into it and they're telling me that I like it, type thing.
Mm-hmm.
And so that, you know, I think I was very lucky that I didn't grow up at that, you know, grow up now, and instead I grew up at a different time.
Well, let me ask, what do you think now then? Like, how do you think it's, I mean, obviously there's a lot that's changed, but like, do you think there's just too much access now that it's almost too difficult for people to find that voice? Do you think it's daunting to find a voice because so many approaches to art in so many different angles has made it like, it's been done before?
Well, the thing is, well, that's part of it too. I mean, I'm looking at it through my lens, you know, so I can't, you know, it seems to me that would be the case, that you just have way too many choices available to you at all times. It's just like in every aspect of life, not just you know, trying to find your voice as an artist. But then again, you know, I didn't grow up, you know, with the internet. I didn't grow up with a phone in my hand, you know, taking in all of this information. So maybe, you know, kids are wired different. I don't know.
Yeah.
It's a strange thing. Like, I've really, you know, being, you know, having, you know, grown up through the 70s and the 80s, and then, you know, coming into this, you know, into the world that we live in now, it's like I've seen so many changes, you know. I mean, just even like, I remember, you know, the first cordless phone, and that was like a shock. Had an antenna that was like 3 feet long.
Oh, man. Saved by the Bell. Zach, he had that great cordless phone, you know? So you ended up then going back to Miami, and like, first, like, I imagine, I don't know, like, I would imagine it, there's like a bit of humbling that goes on, and also like, I don't know, like, where was your mindset when you went back? Did you feel like, I tried New York, I'm over it? Or were you like, I couldn't handle it up there, or I want something different?
Well, I mean, part of my decision to leave Pratt, one, I recognized that I wasn't really sort of, you know, ready for school, but life was really hard here.
Yeah.
I mean, I had no money, you know, my parents at the time.
You had to take out a loan, right? Like you had
yeah,
to take
well,
out
I, I took
loans
out loans,
school.
Which was kind of, I mean, when I think about it, it's just like
compared
insane.
To now.
Well, yeah. Well, I mean, just even like to take out a loan to go to art school seems ridiculous to me now at this point. But it was, it was rough. My last year, the year before I left was really rough. You know, my parents were having financial issues, so I had no money. I used to steal food from the cafeteria at Pratt.
Wow.
I made a fake, this is where the creativity comes
all
in.
Right, here.
But I made this thing that looked like an architectural model, but it was the exact same size as a cafeteria tray, and it had like a little door. So I would order a bunch of stuff, and then when nobody, and I'd have my homework assignment right next to my tray, and then when nobody was looking, I would slide the tray inside of this thing and then buy a bagel or something like that. And it got it got super popular. I used to lend it out to other friends of mine. But it was needless to say, it was rough. I wasn't happy. You know, it was a harsh place. And so I moved back to Miami. You know, I wasn't disappointed to do it. I think it was the right thing. I felt good there. And I quickly sort of reconnected with one friend of mine who had been in my high school art class, so who had gone away to art school, and he had come back too. And we ended up living together. I ended up finishing school down there. And I think we really fed off of each other.
Mm.
I mean, we were like really arrogant assholes, you know, back then, because we
go on.
We were both going to the same school, New World School of the Arts. And I went to go do an interview there with the dean, and he'd been the former dean of painting at Pratt.
Oh, wow.
This really interesting guy named Mel Alexenberg. And we just hit it off right away. And I think the fact that I'd gone to Pratt, like there was a connection there.
Mm-hmm.
And he was one of these people that, you know, sort of really believed in you if you really had some kind of a direction or if you had some sort of confidence in doing something. And, you know, I had plenty at the time, and so did my friend. And he really opened up a lot of doors for me in that regard. And so right when we first started going to school there, there was a big gallery space, and they would do an occasional show in there, but half the time it was empty.
Oh, wow.
And so, you know, nobody else thought about doing this, but we went to Mel and we said, hey, you know, this thing is empty. Can we do a show of our friends, us and our friends? And we did this show. And of course we did. And I mean, not on purpose, but we didn't include anybody else from school except for the two of us. And the rest were just like random friends of ours from high school and like musicians or whatever. And we did this really cool exhibition called 3D Lifestyles. Oh. And it was like, I mean, it was a legit space. And like that, again, like another confidence boost. So there were like all of these people like sort of throughout my life that have been like sort of, you know, like the person in roller derby that like, you know, you're coming around the corner
and
they like kind of, they give you that little extra boost to like kind of keep going.
Yeah.
I've been very fortunate in that regard.
Yeah. I was going to ask one thing I wanted to talk is like, how important do you think it is as an artist to have other people to feed off of? Cause it seems like something that you kind of definitely have thrived with, you know, and like, it seems like your space, your studio here is like open to some other creative people to come in and utilize as well. Like, how important is that for your drive and other artists, I think, I imagine?
You know, everybody's different.
Right.
I think it is really good. And I don't always have I think earlier on in my career, I did have much more of a community, or I felt that I did, in the sense of a community where like, you know, we're all kind of in the same boat. We're all making work together and we're kind of feeding off of each other. Maybe less so now. just because, you know, we're older, yeah. Everybody's kind of like on their own path. You know, a lot of those people, you know, aren't making art anymore. But I think it is crucial. And, you know, and when I do get the opportunity to be around other people, I realize how important it is. But it's very easy to kind of get wrapped up in your own head and your own space and not think about that. And it just takes a little reminder sometime.
Were you at this time, like in Miami and Pratt, like where did you know, like what type of art you wanted to focus on? Was that like, I'm going to do painting, and that's what I feel comfortable with or gravitate towards? Or were you exploring other mediums as well?
From very early on, I'd always made a lot of drawings. So I loved drawing for the immediacy of the mark. Mm-hmm. And I've always loved works on paper because, you know, especially like, you know, just pen and ink stuff, because it's really like a direct connection from your brain through your hand and yeah. directly onto the piece of paper. So drawing was also very big for me. And I loved painting just for the expressive quality mm-hmm. of the material. You know, like no two brush strokes are ever alike, you know, yeah. and like, oh, there's a lot of little mini accidents that happen there as colors are blending together that you can't control, but they, you know, they surprise you every time. So I'd always really kind of focus on that. You know, of course I'd taken some sculpture classes, I'd made things, but the way that I was working for a very long time had a lot to do with kind of being in the moment.
Mm-hmm.
And sculpture doesn't give you that opportunity as much, I think, you know, depending on what it is that you're doing, because you have to You have to plan it out. You have to build it. Instead, I've always been sort of more of like kind of like a, you know, go with the flow kind of approach to making work, where it's more based on
intuition,
your feelings, you know, and seeing what happens, like being part of the conversation,
mm-hmm.
you know, being a participant, not solely the creator.
It sounds like a great interlude into surfing here, you know, because there's so many similarities I find yeah. between those two and the way you just described it, right? Like no brushstroke is the same. No wave yes. is the same.
Exactly.
No, you know, like surfing, you can think about how you want to surf a wave, but mm-hmm. you can't really plan it. Like
you have to work with what you have.
Exactly. You know,
I mean, for me, surfing, I'd always grown up near the water.
Yeah.
There's no real surf in Miami, but I grew up.
Couple
times a year, but I never surfed on those few times a year.
Yeah.
You know, we also didn't have like surf line to know when those yeah. days were going to happen either. And I wasn't living on South Beach. But I grew up on the water, you know, fishing, sailing, water skiing. Mm-hmm. And then right when I moved back to Miami after college, I moved to this building. I was living on Biscayne Bay. And there was this French guy who was a windsurfer.
Mm-hmm.
And I first day I moved there, I see this guy just flying across the bay. And when he came back in, I was like, dude, I want to be your friend and I need to learn how to do this. This is like fascinating. And that was my first obsession. Later when I moved
So you were a windsurfer first.
Yeah. yeah, yeah.
Man, so, just at the tail end of its popularity.
Yeah.
Too,
well, people
like.
Were just starting to kite at yeah, that time because I moved yeah. back here in 98.
Yeah.
And even this guy ended up moving to Hawaii. I even went there and windsurfed with him a little bit there. And like, oh, wow. I remember seeing, you know, Robbie Nash like on like testing out his kites and like doing these insane jumps. And it was pretty, you know, mind boggling to see that at the time. I mean, yeah. now you see it a lot more often.
Yeah, but Robbie Nash is yeah. like god of yeah. windsurfing.
Yeah.
You
oh,
know?
Well, and also
and
like
toe surfing.
And I remember all of the, you know, all the magazines I would see of like Robbie Nash, you know, riding Piahi on his windsurfer, like you're like with a helicopter in the shot. I mean, insane. But so I'd always been attracted to the ocean has always been kind of like my place.
Yeah.
And I can tell you that as a kid, I can picture it right now, laying on the floor of the family room, watching like Wide World of Sports. Mm-hmm. I must have been like 10 or something like that. They had, I'm guessing it could have been like, you know, the Sunset Beach, you know, surf contest or something
probably
like
the
that.
The Duke Invitational,
it
probably.
Could have, it
yeah.
could have been one of those yeah. things. And I just remember seeing somebody standing up on a wave, you know, a giant wave, and he's like in the barrel. And I was like, man, that is just the coolest thing. Like I want to do that at some point in my life. You know, there's something about having that perspective. I mean, mm-hmm. already waves fascinate me to begin with, but that perspective of standing on this like piece of energy that's been traveling all these thousands of miles has always fascinated me. So I got into surfing when I moved here because I just happened to you know, one of the first people I met was a surfer. So we
So, who is that?
This is a friend of mine named Jay Davis, who's an artist, and we ended up, we ended up working together and then sharing, like, we're in the same studio building, and he had a car.
Yeah.
And so we started, you know, going out to the beach, and that's how I picked it up. But back to what you were saying about that connection.
Yeah.
It's exactly that. And I'd been working in this way, this idea of, like, working with what you have. I would even limit, you know, colors and materials sometimes because I didn't want to have too many choices. I wanted to, you know, have to react intuitively and in the moment to things. And so, you know, when it came to surfing, it was, you know, it was like, it really clicked. I was like, this is exactly what it is. And in reference to style, you know, everybody has their own, I use handwriting as an example, or your signature. Everybody has their way of writing, their way of signing their name. Some of them are more elegant than others. You know, some of them are just chicken scratch, right? And same for being on a wave. You've got this thing. There's only so much you can do with it, but everybody's going to kind of react intuitively in their own way. You know, so it's not just standing up on a wave and actually riding it, but even just being in the ocean, you've got forces that are pushing and pulling, and your body reacts intuitively. And some people do it more gracefully than others. Not to say that I do it gracefully, but I'm just...
I like to think that my surfing's more graceful than my signature.
Oh, well, that's good.
And we will be right back. And now, back to our show. You came up here, 98, to kind of New York, back up to New York. Yeah. What caused that? Like, how did you go then from, like, being in Miami, especially, like, 90s, like, art scene was starting to bloom there, you know, and then why come to New York then when you could be in nice, warm weather and be close to everything?
Well, I think that, there were, like, some key people in my life, and Miami, like, that scene was actually quite small.
Yeah.
A lot of them were people from New York or had contacts with New York. And so my last year of school, my thesis professor, who had a nonprofit performing arts organization in Miami, she was from New York. And through that group, I met a lot of sort of New Yorkers, some gallery people, different things like that. So already I was like, and I had the confidence because, like, you know, I mean, Miami was a small pond at the time. And
so
I thought I was hot shit, you know, but of course, like, you know, that was all tempered eventually. but one of the things, like, again, like that confidence, the day that school ended, she pulled me aside and she said, "Hey, I need to talk to you." And I mean, literally, like, class ended, it was our last day. I'd graduated. She said, "I want to buy a painting from you."
Oh, wow.
That was a huge thing.
That's crazy.
That was like, I mean, that was massive. You know, that wasn't just about the money, but it was like, I was like, wow, like, I respect this person. She's brilliant. She's smart. She's taught me so much. And she really believes in me.
She saw something in you.
So she saw something, just like my art teacher in high school did. And then I ended up, I mean, I've worked at, you know, bars and stuff like that. And I can tell you crazy.
I was going to ask you what your first job was when you came up here. What was your first job?
Well, I was still in Miami, actually.
I'm not done.
But then, fast forward like a couple of years, I ended up working at a university gallery, and the director went on to become, like, the head of Christie's here, and, like, you know, now she's doing other stuff. But she had a lot of contacts in New York, and we were bringing exhibitions from galleries and from nonprofit arts, you know, spaces here in New York to Miami. So all of a sudden I started to meet and networking and meeting all these different people, so that by the time I realized, like, you know, New York was really the place I had to go. Mm-hmm. I didn't come up here, you know, with a gallery or a show or anything like that, but I knew a few people, and I was able to get work in the art world.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I started working at galleries. I worked in museums. You know, I did some art handling.
Yeah.
And through there, I started building my network. And it was just the right time. Like, I didn't want to. I felt like Miami was limiting in a lot of ways. You know, for me, like, if I really, you know, wanted to pursue this as a career, and I wanted to figure out a way to not have another job and just live off my work.
So when you came up here, were you able to live off your work, or how much of that struggle was there at the beginning than coming back up here and trying to make it.
Well, I mean,
as an artist.
I mean, it took a good, probably like, I want to say like six years of like, you know, doing all kinds of different jobs. You know, I worked in TV, film, you know, art handling, whatever.
What's that moment like then? Like, I'm very curious, like, because I've just had steady jobs, normal jobs, like nothing of in the creative and you know ventures. Where is that point? Like, what's it like when you're like, I don't need to work here anymore. I can just sell my art. I can just do my art. Holy crap, I could just do my art. Like, that's how I imagine it must be. Is it like gradual or was it like a certain moment?
In my case, I think it was gradual. So by the, you know, before I was completely supporting myself on my work, you know, I'd had pretty good luck, I guess.
Yeah.
And I'd been doing stuff here. I did some shows in Italy and I was selling work, and I was at that time I was working, you know, I worked for Comedy Central and for MTV for like a short period of time, but like doing like, you know, set carpentry and that sort of thing. And those jobs were like sort of these jobs that like you'd work your ass off for, you know, a week or two, and then you wouldn't have, you'd be off for like a couple of weeks. And that was kind of a perfect schedule. And I just remember getting to the point where I was like, I think that if I stop doing these freelance gigs and I really just dedicate the rest of my time to making my artwork, I think I could probably pull it off. So it was a very gradual thing. It wasn't like, you know, I didn't like hit the big time, you know, anything like that. But it was enough for me to cover my rent and, you know, pay for my studio in Williamsburg. And, you know, I had roommates, you know, and what is my studio now was a loft that I lived in.
So let me ask, like, what was Williamsburg like in the late 90s, early 2000s?
Well, my rent for a one-bedroom apartment was $400 a month. And my studio, I think, might have been like $150. It was insane. And then I moved out to Bushwick to the loft where I have my studio now. And that, you know, even then, I mean, I think there was three of us. I think we were paying like $600 a month, you know. I mean, it's a different world. I mean, New York has gotten, it's gotten so expensive.
It's crazy.
Don't even know how young artists could really afford to even be here.
I don't know. I mean, do they even need to be here?
That's a good question. Do I need to be here?
Yeah, honestly. Well, that's an honest question. Like, do artists need to be in New York in order to make it now? Because we're so connected, you know, via online, like, you really don't need to.
Well, you know, I mean, I think it depends. I mean, to say the art world, it's so broad. It's to say, like, you know, food. Like, there's tons of different types of food. Like, the art world, it has, like, all of these different strata. Like, you know, some of them intersect. Mm-hmm. Others don't have anything to do with each other. There's probably artists that are wildly successful that sell a ton of work and make a ton of money that we've never even heard of because it's, like, the person who paints, I don't know, like, you know, calendars or mugs or something like that, you know, but that's their niche. So who knows? I think the contemporary art world, I mean, New York, I think, has always been sort of the center of the contemporary art world.
Yeah. So
in order to be part of that, I mean, it helps to be here.
Well, how much then is the networking? I mean, that's from what it sounds like from many people I've talked to, like, it's so important to have those connections, right? Like, you've been very fortunate to have had, like, those people that have given you that confidence and also kind of the opportunities. Like, how important is the networking, and is that an art form into itself?
I think it is. I mean, I think you have to use everything that you have available to be successful, you know? And so when I talk to young artists or students, I don't think that there's one set formula, you know, to be successful, but there's certainly things that you can do to improve your odds. You know, I think number one is that you need to be making work all the time, which doesn't mean that you have to be making work for an exhibition. Like, you shouldn't feel pressured to, like, have something going on. But if you're working and you're developing your work, then you have something to say.
Yeah.
If you can't say you're an artist and then not do anything, you know what I mean? So doing that, and then as you're doing that you're also building confidence in your own work, which makes it easier for you to speak about it. You know, you have to use every opportunity you can, you know, not be annoying.
Yeah.
You know, but you got to use those
well,
opportunities.
That's an art form, right?
Yeah.
To humble brag.
Yeah.
You need to be able to humble brag.
You know, you have to be able to, you know, you have to use those opportunities and practice. Like, you know, it takes practice to be able to just sit down and have a conversation and not, you know, not get too self-conscious or, you know, at least know what you're talking about. So, like, these are all, like, little things that you can do, things that you can have in your toolbox that can actually get you, put you in a better, I guess, put you in a better position to potentially have some kind of success. It's not a guarantee, mm-hmm. but at least at the end of the day, if you did all of those things, and let's say things don't go the way that you'd like them to, or things didn't work out, at least you can look back and say, well, you know what? I really did put everything I could into this thing, as opposed to looking back and saying, well, shit, I should have. You know, I should have done, you know, why didn't I do this? Or why didn't I do that? Which, you know, it's normal. That's, we're human.
Yeah, but you're also like, you know, there's also a difference of like someone who just wants to be famous and someone who wants to create.
Yeah.
You know, and that's like, that's also a whole discussion.
And that's, you know, and I think even, you know, maybe more so now.
Yeah.
I mean, I was a visiting artist at a residency program like a few years ago. And I had to do studio visits with all the artists that were there.
Yeah.
And overwhelmingly, the first question I got from them was not how am I going to get famous, but they're like, how do I get a gallery? I mean, these are like kids that are, you know, barely graduated or anything like that, which is a valid question, but you got to focus on your work first.
Yeah.
You know, it's like, but it was like, they were already like, you know, way ahead of themselves in terms of what they wanted to do, which, you know, maybe for some they can pull that off because they do have talent and have the ease to be able to do those things. But for the most part, you know, I think that's you know, I don't think it's realistic, you know, because that, you know, you never know. Like all, you know, all of these people that are famous, like, you know, I mean, some of them, you know, they did it, you know, they've done it through hard work, but they're, you know,
it's luck.
It's a lot of it is luck, but you have to. But the more you're out there, you know, when these doors open, you have to walk through them. That's the key. You know, you have to, and a lot of it has to do with mindset, you know, and you can't really look at, you can't think about, you know, what somebody else is doing, you know, versus, you know, or thinking whether or not they deserve it or not. It doesn't matter because you don't really know the whole context.
Well, it's like surfing, right? Like if you're thinking, I need to be a pro surfer, you know, one, you're setting yourself up for disappointment. Two, you're really then not going to focus on the actual act of surfing, which is the most important thing.
Well, I mean, listen, for art school, I don't know what the percentage is, but of who, when they graduate from art school, even work in the arts, let alone have a career selling work. Like working in the arts could be like, you know, I mean, working at a gallery or you know, being or teaching or something like that. It's a very small percentage. So you have to be realistic. And also, like, be super self-aware and understand where you fit in. Like, mm-hmm. you know, what, you know, you can make a certain type of work that doesn't have anything to do with the hippest gallery, you know. So you can't, like, focus on that thing. Like, understand where, you know, where you think you're, you know, you've kind of fit into this, like, giant puzzle because it's huge.
Yeah.
And I'm a true believer that everybody has an audience mm-hmm. somewhere.
Yeah.
You just got to figure out, you got to find them.
If you look online, there's plenty of audiences, you know?
Well, no, I mean, but like an audience is actually going to, you know, buy something and you know, keep you going.
And we will be right back. And now back to our show. I got to ask, you know, then you had a brief dalliance with rollerblading, didn't you?
With rollerblades.
Yeah, didn't you
so
like...
Where are you getting all this information?
Oh, you know, I'm like James Lipton, man. Yeah. Like, Actors Studio. I just find this shit randomly.
Well, I can't really rollerblade very well, but that
you
was...
You did rollerblade for your job.
I had a job on rollerblades promoting, like, it was like some chicken, fried chicken place, like, in deep Brooklyn. And like, I mean, these were wild times back then and I didn't even know how to rollerblade. And they basically gave me rollerblades. They gave me one of those like sandwich signs that you would have and a handful of like these coupons for chicken. I was with my old roommate, James. And, we got there, we put these things on, we started handing these things out. We almost like, we got mobbed. And we basically just like threw the coupons up in the air and just got the hell out of there. I mean, it's like best I could on rollerblades.
Bunch of kids in like sandwich suit, you know, like on rollerblades handing out free coupons.
It was ridiculous.
I had to ask. I was like reading that. I was like, this guy rollerbladed. All right. So then surfing, right? Like, let's get into the important stuff.
Okay,
the art is like, whatever, you know, the surfing is a priority here. Your friend had kind of gotten you into it. Where did you first go to surf? What were the first beaches? So how did you get introduced then?
So, like I said, he's from South Carolina and he's an artist and we became, I mean, really like we connected like within the first couple of days that I'd moved back to New York. And, We would go to Gilgo all the time. We never went to Rockaway at first.
Sketch then.
Yeah, I guess maybe that was it.
You don't want to leave your car out.
No. So we would go to Gilgo and, you know, like a lot of beginners, I probably made the stupid mistake of, you know, trying to surf a board that was too small for me. So you'd think that after 20 years, I'd probably be a better surfer. And if I'm not, it's because I didn't have the right boards to start off with. But still, it didn't matter. Like, I mean, for me, that was the thing. Like, I never gave up. Like, I ate shit for years, you know, and like, you know, you'd have like a little bit of progress and then like, you know, a couple of steps forward and like, you know, many more steps back. But I always loved it. I was always happy when I got out of the water.
Did you find that surfing and being a surfer in New York helped open doors with the art world at all? Did it, or at least connect with certain other artists? Because there's like a long list of incredible artists who happen to surf, you know?
Yeah, and even like, I mean, it still opens doors, you know? It's opened doors with a lot of different people just because, you know, you don't automatically...
Got you on this podcast.
Yeah, exactly. You don't automatically like sort of assume that, you know, that people are surfers living in New York City. And then like when you come across one, there's like this sort of this common bond. So, you know, for the work, I think that as far as the art world's concerned, I mean, I think that it, you know, it just meshes very well with my process.
Yeah.
So that just, it was just automatic, you know, so it's hard for me not to mention it, you know, within the context of my work. Although it's not about surfing at all. So, you know, I try to like, you know, not get too excited sometimes to talk about surfing because I'm trying to be more serious about, you know, what I'm doing. But I do use it as an example of like that idea of being in the moment. A lot of times when I do studio visits, you know, most people aren't surfers, but you know, a lot of people ski.
Yeah.
You know, and it's kind of the same thing. You know, when you go down a mountain, you're reacting intuitively to whatever the terrain is there. And although the mountain isn't moving, you know, you can do that same run a bunch of times, but it's never going to be exactly the same.
So then how did it affect your style of art? Like, did it, you know, in what way would you say that surfing has seeped in, you know, to your style?
I don't think that it's visually. I don't think that it's really, I don't know that that's the best way to put it. Like for me, I think it's helped me maybe understand my process a little bit more. I mean, granted, and some of the stuff that I do does, you know, some relate it to, you know, there's a lot of movement, you know, so some people see water, you know, they're connected for sure.
Yeah.
I mean, but I think it's helped me understand. And actually it's funny. I did a public commission for the MTA. I did a train station out in Brooklyn. And initially I was a finalist for a different station and I didn't get up in the Bronx. I didn't get it. And they ended up giving me this other station on the way out to Coney Island because they knew that I was a surfer and that I was connected. I was like, you know, there's a lot of movement in my work. And they, you know, one of the curators told me that specifically. They're like, it just made more sense.
That's awesome.
Yeah.
That's so cool. How did you meet your partner?
So we met, because
it seems like she's had quite an impact on your career as well,
right? She certainly supported me and put up with me over the years. but yeah, Micaela, she's from Italy. And when I met her the first time, she was working as the U.S. editor for an Italian contemporary art magazine. And prior to me ever knowing her, they reviewed one of my first shows in New York.
Really?
And I ended up meeting her one day when I went to the gallery. She was there. I had no idea who she was. But the gallerist at the time, this is a small gallery, you know, to kind of like grease the wheels a little bit, he gave her a drawing to thank her for having had somebody write about my show. And I walk in, she's there, they introduce us, and she's like, oh, thank you so much for the drawing. And I was like, what? I was like, what drawing? I had no idea. I find out later that this guy had given her a drawing. And then that was it. We never saw each other again for about a year.
Wow.
And then we reconnected with, and we had, you know, obviously like being in the New York art world, we had a lot of friends in common. We reconnected about a year later at an opening, and she came over for a studio visit. We started to spend time together, and we've been together for a long time.
So she's figures into this one story I want you to tell about how you were able to get representation from Gallery Lelong, because it's a longer story actually than just showing up to the gallery.
Yeah.
And she kind of like,
well, she
put the crack on you, real crack the whip almost.
Well, I mean, the story is that she was co-curating an exhibition in Italy.
Yeah.
In Verona. And I wasn't in it. And this particular exhibition was a group show that this family who had, you know, they were art collectors, they were opening up this gallery space. They really wanted somebody from New York. They wanted a New York curator to work with them. Obviously, yeah. She was an easy choice because she also spoke Italian, but they also wanted somebody who had contacts and was going to be able to get works from major galleries. And the show was actually perfect. It was called Neo-Baroque. And my work was, you know, really fit into the show, but she's very professional, and she felt that it wouldn't be cool to include me in this exhibition. And at the last minute, one of their artists pulled out.
Whoa.
And this person was going to do this giant site-specific wall drawing or wall piece, whatever, at the gallery. It was like 60 feet long. And this dude pulls out at the last second because he had a conflict with another gallery that he was working with. And
So she didn't like, you know, take a bat to his knee or anything, right?
No, not at all. And actually, it was her co-curator said, she's like, we got to put E in the show.
Wow.
Like, he's like, you know, he's perfect. He could totally do it. And so she was in Italy at the time. She called me up. I remember she woke me up. She's like, you're in the show. And then she hung up the phone.
How much did you have to prepare for that? How much time?
You know, I don't recall. Well, the piece was done there on site.
But to prepare,
I don't remember. That was in 2005. But long story short, I did that exhibition.
Yeah.
They did an incredible catalog. And one of the artists in the show also showed with Gallery Lelong.
Yeah.
And I was with the co-curator one day in Chelsea, just going to shows. And at the time, I had left that small gallery that I'd been working with. And I just kind of, you know, I felt like I was in a place where I was going to be able to find something better.
Yeah.
And we went to Lelong to go drop off the catalog, and I met the director there. And she gave him the book, and she said, oh, you know, this is Emilio. You know, he was also in the show. He's like, oh, great. That's really nice. And he kind of flipped through the book, and I was like, oh, yeah, that's what I do. And he was, like, very polite and very nice. We're still dear friends. I ask him the story. He's like, I have no recollection of this whatsoever. But when we left, Joyce, the co-curator from the show, she's like, you know, he really reacted to your work. I was like, really? I was like, I don't think so. I was like, she's like, I'm going to call him and tell him that he should really do a studio visit now before you get snatched up by somebody else. And it is true that at that time I was talking to another gallery. He came over. This is like, you know, 2005, 2006, if I recall. He came over to do a studio visit, and it just so happened that that particular gallery they were looking for a younger male abstract painter. I mean, it was very specific.
I didn't know that it was like a typecast, like a casting.
I mean,
call.
I think in some cases
we're looking
it is.
For a young male.
Well, they were thinking they were
brownish
thinking,
hair, good looking. You know, surfs a little.
Well, they found him. Well, the hair's not brown anymore.
Well, not anymore. I mean, it's silver now, but back then, you know.
But so I mean, I mean, maybe it wasn't that specific, but basically, you know, that was like something in their program that they didn't have and they were looking for. And I just really hit it off with this guy. His boss came over. We, you know, we had a conversation. You know, I think that they liked what they saw. I kind of fit the bill. You know, I was able to talk about the work, and they said that they, you know, they asked me if I wanted to be represented by them. So that was a huge, I mean, that was huge for my career. I mean, it changed my life, really.
Explain to our listeners, like, the prominence of Gallery Le Long.
Well, it's a historic gallery. So, you know, it's probably, you know, it's not the hippest gallery, you know, but it's a gallery that's very well respected, you know, based in Paris. The Daniel Le Long, who founded the gallery, is an art world legend. I mean, this guy, you know, worked with, you know, with Francis Bacon, with Miro, like all of these. I mean, it's just like, he is art history on two legs. And he's just like a lovely, incredible person. And I thankfully, even though by the time that I started working with the gallery, he wasn't really super involved, but because I did a couple of shows with them in France, in Paris, I got a chance to spend some time with him. And, you know, I mean, that's one of the best things that, I mean, there's many great things that came out of that experience working with the gallery, but getting to know him and be able to say that he's a friend was really, really special. Because all of a sudden, like, these things, these pictures and these books that I'd looked at when I was a kid, like, they're like the degrees of separation start to like shrink, and you're like, oh my God, like, this is like, you know, I can, you know, I'm having a conversation with the person who gave this person a show. Like, how's that possible? Like, you know, stuff that you would never imagine.
It's humbling.
Yeah. So it was a huge deal for me. I think that I was, this is also like before the financial crisis, which kind of changed a lot of things.
Yeah.
But I was also quite naive, I think, at the time. Imagine, you know, for me, that was like, I mean, that was like a home run that I got these guys. And I'll never forget, we were sitting at my studio or across the table from each other. And they said, look, we want to represent you, and we want to basically, you know, make your life easy so that all you need to really worry about is making artwork. Right. So like, that's music to my ears. And I thought, like, naively, I was like, man, I've arrived. Like, that's it.
Yeah.
Like, everything from here on out is just icing on the cake. Of course, that's just not true.
No.
And, you know, the stakes get higher. You know, you have to work. The hustle never ends.
No.
You know, but at the time, I was like, oh, look, like, there's all these other these other artists that have been with this gallery for a really long time. Like that's, you know, this could be me,
like,
and
this is it,
blah, blah,
like,
blah.
Right? Like, but this is where you're going to be for most of your life.
But it's a relationship like any other. Mm-hmm. Things change within the relationship. The art world changed a lot, you know, with the financial crisis. You know, I worked with them for about 10 years, and, you know, I've got work into, you know, a bunch of different institutions, different museums. I had I did three solo shows here, a couple in Paris, and it opened up a lot of doors. And, you know, really, if it wasn't for them, I don't know that I would be able to, you know, survive independently for the time that I've been able to do. And I, you know, once I left the gallery, I started just working. I was doing a lot more public art stuff. So I did the project with the MTA. I did a couple of big video installations, one in Times Square and one at the Kennedy Center in DC. And through the years of working with the gallery, I knew a lot of art advisors who were working with big developers and different clients. So I was doing a lot of big commissions, all the while kind of knowing that that body of work I'd kind of done everything that I could with it.
Mm-hmm.
And I knew deep down that I needed to do something else, but I just wasn't sure what that was going to be. I just needed a shift, because that whole idea of you know, the escape, like the original reasons, like one of the original reasons why I got into making artwork, like, is that excitement, that escape, that being able to go to another world just wasn't happening for me anymore. And so I needed a challenge to try and do something else. And then, you know, I started playing around in 2019 with making these new paintings that are much more sort of traditional, not with the technique that I'd been working with for 20 years. And then the pandemic happened, and I just kind of, you know, shut in and started creating.
Well, you left Le Long right around in 2015, roughly.
It was 2015-16.
So, like, our common friend Jeremy said, like, you know, it's really brave what you did, like, leaving a gallery, but then going in a different direction with your art, like not staying in the same style, trying a new style, trying something new out. Like, how has that process been, trying to work out like the new direction, the new challenge?
Well, at first, I mean, it was scary because, you know, I'm sort of really linked. I mean, my work, that previous body of work, which I still do make those paintings occasionally, but it's a very kind of specific kind of work. It's very recognizable.
Mm-hmm.
So for the people, and that's kind of what I, you know, what my career was kind of based on, was that very specific kind of work. And to do something else, you know, some people are like, man, are you sure you want to do that? Like, you know, I just felt inside that I had to do something. I just had to try something different. And, you know, I've always been much more inspired by more sort of like classical painting, you know, more traditional painting in general, and the landscape and whatnot. And so I was like, I want to make more traditional paintings, you know, with oil on linen, and in, like, you know, and just make this other work that's going to challenge me to do something else. Like, I know how to make these other paintings and I'll continue to make them, but this is just something that I feel I needed to do. And it was also, whereas that previous work was about intuition and being in the moment, there is still some of that in this new work. But I think that as I've gotten a little bit older, I'm a little bit more introspective, and I think I need to slow down a little bit in my mind and think a little bit more when I'm making work. And that, the just painting in oil, it's a much slower process. It kind of does all of those things. It's much more meditative. You know, I got, you know, during, I'd always kind of, you know, dabbled, but like during the pandemic, I really started, you know, I started meditating a lot, and it's really sort of helped sort of focus me into something different, because I thought, and now, and looking back, I mean, at first, like, I mean, if you see the first ones, there were like, you know, a lot of them ended up in the trash, but eventually I kind of got to something that I felt was a good sort of departure point.
Should have went dumpster diving there.
Yeah.
Well, like, then let me ask, like, then, like, that you're in the painting realm, and it feels like the art world currently is really consuming digital art and structure and performative art almost. And what I wonder then is there space still for painting in the art world? Like, does the art world still react as strongly to painting as it does to NFTs right now, or any of these other kind of crazy kind of offshoots?
No, I think absolutely. I mean, you know, I'm not saying this because I'm a painter, but I think that there's something, you know, NFTs are a whole other thing. It's like a whole other ecosystem.
Yeah.
You know, I think in order to be successful with NFTs, you also have to be part of that community in order to do that stuff. I don't get particularly excited about making digital work.
Yeah.
Because I like the physicality of materials. And I think that I can't, you know, there's reasons why people like stand in line, you know, to go and see paintings that are hundreds of years old and pay money at a museum to go and do that. It's because what the painting offers that a digital work doesn't offer is that I've always looked at paintings as a time capsule.
Yeah.
You know, so when you're standing in front of that painting, whether it's an old master, or whether it's one of my paintings or whatever, you're looking at this painting, you're basically standing the same distance away from the person who made this thing.
Mm-hmm.
You know, so there's something about that. There's an energy that's there in the work that doesn't exist on a screen.
Yeah.
So that's, you know, so I don't, I mean, you know, people still buy plenty of paintings, so I'm not worried that people are going to stop buying paintings.
No, it's just, it's funny just seeing what's on trend, I guess. Like, what it seems like the hurrah of a lot of stuff, it feels like, at least in the pop culture realm, that attention has gone to more ephemeral things, you know, things that are less permanent almost.
Yeah. I mean, you know, I'm probably not even the best person to ask, because I don't keep up with it, but I don't know. For me, it seems like I don't hear people talking about NFTs nearly as much as they were
a year ago,
a year and a half ago, or 2 years ago. Yeah.
Crypto bros don't have the funds.
Yeah, I guess so. You know, so I don't know. I mean, I think that there's interesting things that you can do with NFTs, you know, but, you know, I can only do so much.
Yeah.
And I also think, like, it's also like a connection with surfing too. Like, you know, I came to surfing late, you know, I've been surfing for for 20 plus years now. I'm 50 now. I mean, I think I'll be able to keep surfing for at least another
20, 30 years.
Yeah, 20 or 30 years. But I want to catch as many waves as possible between now and those, like whenever I can't do it anymore. And I start thinking about that stuff when it comes to paintings. It's like, how many paintings am I, you know, do I have in me? Like, how many am I going to be able to do? And that, to me, is way more interesting. You know, it's like, I like this idea of the development. And also, having developed a body of work for 20 years that, you know, if I look at the, if I show you the inception and then what they look like now, I mean, it's like, it's such an interesting evolution. When I think about these new oil paintings that I'm doing, I can only start to like imagine, like, man, what are these things going to look like in 5 years and 10 years and 20 years? You know, that's exciting. And so much of it is about being excited, you know?
Let me ask you then, like, I want to discuss with you your idea of paradise, because you once stated that you started thinking about paradise and you have this idea of an idyllic place, but in your experience, there's always a dark undercurrent that is happening. And I was just kind of curious, like, how that factors into your work and your current work, particularly.
Well, this my work is not like, it's not specifically about one thing, but I like to call, like, you know, these themes just sort of departure points where it gives the viewer and the person like some sort of point of reference to like start from, and then you can kind of go wherever you want. You know, I never tried to sort of put very specific things in my paintings because when they're more open to interpretation, I think it's more inviting to more people.
Absolutely.
And it's just the way that I approach things. But talking about paradise, I've traveled a lot, you know, in the Caribbean and in Central and South America. You know, I've spent a lot of time. I've done a number of projects in Cuba. And I personally have always gravitated to the tropics.
Yeah.
Maybe because I'm Cuban, I don't know. But that's there's something about, there's like a, I don't know, there's like, it's, there's like a heat. I mean, besides the physical heat, there's like, you know, there's something, there's like, there's passion, there's all of this stuff there. And incredible beauty. Like, you know, just the tropical landscape has always fascinated me just because of the diversity of all the different plants and trees and whatnot. But sadly, in all these places that, to me, or I like seem idyllic and they do look like a paradise. You know, if you really scratch the surface, there's a lot of darkness and struggle and sadness underneath. And as I was starting to develop this new body of work, in 2019, I did a project in Cuba for the Havana Biennial. And
along the Malecon.
On the Malecon, yeah. Ooh. Well, this is the second time I did it. So the first time was in 2015, completely different, you know, situation. Obama was in office.
Yeah.
There was a lot of optimism that Cuba was going to change finally after all this time. I mean, as much as I'm American, like my Cuban identity is, it's huge. It's like a huge part. It's informed so much of who I am. So I can't, you know, I can't discount that at all. But there was a lot of optimism at the time, and I had an opportunity to participate in this show that was called Detrás del Muro, Behind the Wall. And this was an outdoor exhibition curated by a dear friend of mine who did these installations along the Malecon, which is like the big sort of boulevard that runs along the water in Havana. And it's like iconic. You've seen photos of like the waves crashing it's over beautiful. The wall and all of that stuff. And so when I was asked to participate, I was a little hesitant, honestly, because even though I traveled to Cuba and I have family there, I didn't really want to participate in something that was sponsored by the government.
Yeah.
That was problematic for me. On the flip side, I've got family there that have been sort of following my career.
And you've had
for
seen
years,
them, right?
You know, I'd met, I'd met some of them. Yeah. I had a very close connection with them because my first trip to Cuba was in, it was in 2000, I think.
Yeah.
And I'd connected with all these people. And I was like, man, this is an opportunity to actually share what I do with these people that you know I care so much about that are there, that are never going to be able to see my work somewhere else, and or at least you know, more or less. And not only that, as a kid growing up in Miami with this Cuban identity, I don't think that there was ever a time that I was in the water in the ocean and didn't, even though maybe I wasn't looking in the direction of Cuba, but always like sort of thinking, God, just on the other side of the horizon, there's this place that has informed everything in my life, you know, like, you know, the roots just there. And so I get this opportunity to do this exhibition there on the Malecon. Now my artwork was going to be facing in the other direction, instead of looking towards Florida, towards the United States. So I was like, man, this is really kind of like, you know, this is kind of a really beautiful idea. And so I created this piece and shared it with my family. It was fantastic. I'll have to show you the photo that we took. That's like all these people in front of this like 60-foot long, you know, mural. At the time, I think it was like the biggest mural that's ever been, you know, exhibited and, you know, publicly in Cuba. And so I got invited again in 2019 by that same friend of mine. And, you know, circumstances were totally different. Mm-hmm. The infrastructure was worse. There wasn't, you know, much support for this project. But I wanted to do something with the people of the neighborhood. Because previously I'd made the work here in New York and sent it down there and we put it up. In this case, I was like, that doesn't make any sense. Like, I want to, you know, and it's a very poor neighborhood, this particular neighbor, Centro Habana. Mm-hmm. And I thought, I was like, you know, let me do something with the people that are there so that they can have like a collective pride about this thing instead of just like some dude, you know, a Cuban American guy who shows up and, you know, just kind of puts something up on a wall, because nobody gets a chance to do anything on a wall there, you know, for the most part, you know.
Yeah.
And so I did this collaborative piece with the people from the neighborhood. And it was like this long, like 100-foot long mural. Didn't go as planned. We had a lot of problems, you know, namely
government.
Government things. Tons of the materials got stuck in customs. I mean, I even had like a handwritten letter from the Minister of Culture inviting us to go there and do this thing. And they still couldn't get their shit together to get our stuff out of a warehouse. It wasn't that it was like tucked away somewhere else. The stuff arrived, but it was just being held at this warehouse in this random place. I even went there and could see my stuff. I could see my materials right there.
Oh, jeez.
I even tried to bribe the guys there, which I actually felt bad afterwards because I was like, I have to get this stuff out. I'm like, what is, like, you know, this is, you know, bullshit. I'm from New York, man. We got to make things happen. And so I tried to bribe these guys, and it was just like, it was total panic. Because like
sketchy
all of the,
almost because you're
well
like,
no because I mean any of these guys, like, you know, they would have been happy to have that money. They really could have used it, but of course they're all looking at each other like, well, dude, if you take it, I'm gonna snitch on you. It was like it was really, it opened, I mean, these are not things that I'm, you know, don't know about. I understand how everything works there, and I understand how challenging it is. And it was just like, you know, there was just like the sadness, and I had 3 weeks to make this project, but I ended up having to do it in 1 week because for 2 weeks everything was stuck there, and I had a lot of time to spend with myself, with family, with a bottle of rum, you know. And I got into like a really dark place there. And when I came back, I was thinking a lot about that, and I was like, this is what are these new paintings going to be about? Or at least like I need somewhere to start from. And I started thinking about that whole idea of like, what is really paradise? Is it real? Like, does it just exist in our heads?
It's fantasy.
Yeah.
You know, I cannot tell you how many times I've traveled to beautiful, idyllic places that seem paradise, and on surface, you know, you're there for the first week maybe, and you're like, everything's great. And then as you get to know people and you get to understand, like, there's so much more undercurrent. There's so much more happening below the surface that is, you know, people are struggling, and people move to paradise thinking, right, I'm here, I'm in paradise. And then they don't realize, like, oh, I just brought my shit with me to paradise. Like, everything's not going to be perfect because I still got to deal with what I'm carrying, you know. And I can't tell you how many times I've met people who've done that, you know, move to paradise thinking everything's going to be great. And then they still keep falling into the same trappings that they did back home. You know, there's no, paradise is a state of mind. It's not a place, really. Right. You know,
so You put it perfectly. I mean, that was, and so that was one of the things that that really kind of stuck with me from that trip. And there was just, I mean, having seen all of the, having gone to Cuba the first time in 2000, where the circumstances were pretty tough, then going back in 2015 and like actually seeing that, like, wow.
Progress, right?
I mean, the place had changed.
Yeah.
I mean, there was things that were available that weren't available before. Like, it was all this stuff. And then going back 4 years later and just seeing how all of that hope, all of that stuff had kind of disappeared. Mm. There was just like, you know, even just, you know, some of my family, like, I mean, they were, you know, in really, really tough spots. And it's just, and it's such a, I mean, for me personally, it's such a sad, sad thing. I mean, not that, you know, there's a lot of problems all over the world, but yeah, this is one that I'm, you know, particularly close to because I have, I have a personal connection with, and it's just such a sad thing. I mean, that place is so incredible.
It's beautiful.
Yeah, it's beautiful. There's so much culture.
Yeah.
The, you know, you go to Havana, it's a giant city with like incredible architecture, all the stuff, but half the stuff's falling apart. It's just like, it's depressing, man.
It was like my wife and I went right around probably like, yeah, 2019, maybe, mm-hmm. 18 or 19. And it's funny, like it just, yeah, like I was like, holy crap, like all these beautiful historic buildings are just crumbling and there's right. just no... And then you go to some richer touristy areas sure. and you see everything really nice. And then yeah. once you start walking along the Malecon and you go one block in on certain areas, you're yeah. like, oh, shit.
Well, not to mention, man, the kind of stuff that people are doing just to survive.
Oh, my
and
gosh.
And that's just like really, really sad, man.
It's really tough.
You know, I saw some really just like really sad, dark things on that trip. And, you know, it's just like I don't really have any desire to go back there anytime soon, you know, not until something gives, man. And it's very difficult because I do know a lot of artists there.
Yeah.
I know artists that have gone to jail, you know, just for expressing their views. I mean, my first trip there was to work on a project. It was a research project about the history of performance art in Cuba during the 80s. And at that time, a lot of visual artists had been censored by the government. So they started doing performance art, but almost in a vacuum because there wasn't like, you know, they didn't have a ton of information about other performance art that was happening
outside.
Nothing was
coming out of it in the 80s either, you know?
Well, they didn't have a ton of information about other performances that were happening outside of Havana, like what was happening in the United States or in Europe. So a lot of these things developed, like it sort of became very popular because it was this ephemeral artwork. And a dear friend of mine, Glexis Novoa, who's a great Cuban artist, he had done a lot of performances at the time, and he came with this idea of like doing this research trip to compile a chronology of all of the performances that took place between 1980 and 1990, because it just so happened that the 80s were bookended by, you know, in the beginning, censorship, more censorship than there was before. And then in the 90s, a lot of visual artists left Cuba. They went to Mexico. They went to Europe, and eventually went to, or some came to the United States. And so, I saw firsthand, how artists like me were being oppressed by government, you know, just out of fear.
Yeah.
You know, and people that, you know, got, you know, for doing a performance, got sent to jail with, like, you know, with murderers and rapists and stuff. I mean, it was really crazy. That was a huge, huge, huge eye opener for me, because I'd always, you take everything for granted here, you know.
We most certainly do.
I mean, you go there and there's a glass ceiling. There's only so much you can say or you can do. And you know, Cubans are like the, you know, heavyweight champions of exaggerating things. Mm-hmm. So I'm like, man, it can't be that bad, you know, right?
Yeah.
In your mind, you're like, wow, is it really that bad? And then, you know, I went there, and sure enough, it was. I mean, we even got in trouble because we didn't have permission to do what we were doing to do this research. And there was like a whole system of people, you know, sort of, letting other people know what people were doing. And like, you had to be really, really careful.
Every block has someone that keeps an eye on what's happening there. And they're like an informant for the government, basically. It's almost like a volunteer type of thing too. which yeah. is pretty wild.
I mean, I don't know how that structured. Works. I mean, I don't know if it's that much like that now, but I mean, I'm sure. I'm not surprised, you know. I mean, just recently there was a lot of, you know, a lot of protests in yeah. Cuba, like in a way that they'd never seen before, mm-hmm. and really like led by artists, and a lot of these guys got in really big trouble.
Oof.
Which is wild. Like you can never imagine. Like I can never imagine that, you know, until you see it firsthand, and then you really realize, you know, how much, you know, somebody really has to struggle just to survive.
And would you say that is what's been informing a lot of your work lately then? Kind of like that kind of, or at least that was a jumping off
point?
Well,
no, I mean, that's like, this was a much deeper sort of dive.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. So,
no,
yeah.
It was just more like, I mean, it was just more of a personal thing. Yeah. I mean, my work is not about Cuba. It's not,
no,
I mean, but it
no,
does,
no,
but it's, no.
No,
but I think that like that idea of paradise.
Yeah.
Like what is paradise? You know, there's the darkness that's underneath the surface of paradise, or maybe it's just underneath the surface of our own psyche, you know, it's inside of us.
Yeah.
So that was just kind of like, I just felt that was like a, kind of like an interesting place that I could start and people could maybe relate to.
Yeah. I really would love to keep continuing this conversation, but I feel like, you know, I know you have a time limit, but I have to end with one last question, you know, that our friend Jeremy had told me to ask mm-hmm. you about the time that you had a huge opening and you decided to go surfing instead, or surfing right before it.
Right. Well, that was like the best thing you could do, right?
Yeah.
I mean.
So what was going on here? What happened? He's like, got to ask Emilio about that.
Well, Michaela was really upset about me going surfing because she's like, what if something happens to you, like the day of, like this is like a big deal, like this is like a big day.
This is a big. Give us a frame of reference, like how the show.
I can't
was.
Remember which it was. One of my solo shows at Le Long. It was, you know, I don't remember which one it was exactly, but there were waves that day. Like, I mean, look, there's something really special when you get an opportunity to do something like that.
Yeah.
And I'm very, very thankful. I've never taken that for granted. Just to be able to have a bunch of people, you know, come and see the fruits of your labor. You know? I mean, it takes a lot to fill that space. Was actually quite large. So it was like a big chunk of time and effort that it took for me to make all that work. So to be able to get all of that attention and have it be about you is pretty amazing. You know, so that's already a good day.
But you know, but
you
when
wake
you get
up,
waves, when
you
have
wake
waves
up and then there's
York,
waves, you're like, well, you gotta go. You know? And so I did, and, you know, but it's also one of those things too. It's like, you know what it's
you're
like.
I could do both.
Well, no, but you know how you feel after you've gone surfing. Yeah. Like, you know, it's like you're much more relaxed. I mean, you know, I generally don't get super nervous when it comes to openings and that sort of thing. I enjoy it. Like, I mean, because these are, you know, opportunities that I'm super lucky mm-hmm. to have, and I want to, like, you know, soak it up and not be stressed out about it. But certainly, you know, there are some nerves involved. And so, you know, a little surf in the beginning,
takes,
you know, early
the
in the morning,
off.
Like totally takes the edge off. And then you could tell people, you're like, oh yeah, I was surfing earlier today.
You're like, oh, sorry, I got to flex some sand
out
of my eyebrows.
Exactly. Like,
oh
yeah, why is your nose red? Like, I was like, you know.
Oh my God, why did you have nasal drain all over the, you know, all over the artwork all
but
of a sudden?
I think she had read some, like, there's a book, I can't remember what it was called, but there's some book, it's about an artist and he's like going to his opening, but he gets like hit by a cab and he dies. And so she like had this like idea in her head. I mean, but it's been that, like, there's on multiple occasions, there's been some sort of like occasion, like some big occasion. And I decide like, oh, I got to go surfing first. like even if it's like, I mean, even if I'm leaving tomorrow to go on a surf trip and there's waves today, you got to go.
Absolutely. Yeah. Absolutely. Did you make it to the show on time at least?
Oh yeah, for sure. I made it. Are you kidding? I'm gonna like soak up every like last second of that opportunity.
I love that. So, Emilio, where can our listeners find your work if they want to check you out or see the pieces that you've been working on?
Well, there's a few places. Yeah. I mean, if you're, you know, on social media, on Instagram, I am Emilio Perez Art.
There we go.
And then also my website is Emilio Perez Art as well.
.com.
Yeah, .com.
And gallery?
And then gallery. Right now, the only gallery that I'm working with is in Miami, mm-hmm. Frederick Schnitzer Gallery. You can see my train station. If you're in New York and you're going out to Coney Island on the N train, I'm at the 18th Avenue station.
Nice.
And I mean, I work in a couple of museums, but they're not necessarily hanging on the walls.
And uptown in the Rockaways, maybe.
Yeah, exactly.
Emilio, thank you so much for coming on, man.
A pleasure.
Really appreciate it. Honestly, like, we have to get you back on, I think, because there was.
Oh, there's going to be a part two?
Why not? I mean, there was. I felt like we were just hitting our stride, to be honest.
Yeah.
And I was like, oh, he's got to go. He's got like a fancy dinner now.
Yeah,
you know?
It's not really. No, I apologize.
but definitely, maybe you and Jeremy, we can get on.
Be fun.
And we can discuss the topic, what is art?
Yes.
Awesome, man. Thank you so much.
You're very welcome.
All right. And for all our listeners, don't forget to check us out at Swell Season Surf Radio. And also, you can go to swellseasonsurfradio.com. We are recorded at the NewsStand studio at Rockefeller Center in the heart of Manhattan. And we'll all check you on down the line soon.